All right, open your Bibles to the book of John, chapter 20. And we will hopefully get into chapter 21 as well. I'm not necessarily going to go verse by verse through this, but I want to show you the highlights of what we're going to talk about tonight, which is the post-resurrection appearances of the Lord Jesus Christ. Last Sunday was Resurrection Sunday. We talked about that. And so I thought it would be good on this Wednesday night following Easter that we would go ahead and look at what happened directly after the resurrection of Christ. And so we're going to examine the appearances that he made to various individuals after he rose from the dead. So we begin in John chapter 20, and we'll begin in verse 11. The very first person that Jesus appeared to following his resurrection was Mary Magdalene. This is, to me, very interesting and significant that he would pick Mary Magdalene to be the first person that he appeared to after his resurrection. The story we pick up in verse 11, but Mary stood without at the sepulcher or the grave, weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the sepulcher and seeth two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. Of course, the angels had already removed the stone. Jesus had already risen. And, you know, apparently these angels were sitting there. I mean, Jesus had already risen from the dead. And, you know, you say, well, why were the angels still there? You know, I mean, stop and think about it. Why would the angels be sitting there? Can you imagine the scene if you're Mary? You look, first of all, the stone is gone, and we've talked before about how large and how heavy the stone was that the Romans put in front of the grave. And then, of course, the seal and the signet of Rome over the stone that was in front of the sepulcher. So, you know, the fact that the stone was even moved was a major shock to Mary. Who could have moved it? It took many men to move that stone. No telling how many men it took to actually move the stone, and animals to get it in place. And then, of course, it was guarded 24 hours by Roman soldiers, you know, who were instructed not to let anyone, you know, near there. And so the fact that the stone was gone was a major surprise to Mary. She looks in, you can kind of picture her as she very slowly and carefully approaches the entrance of this opening, and what is she going to see and so forth. And she looks in, there's nobody. And then there's two men, we're told they're angels, that are inside the sepulcher sitting down, one at the head of where Jesus was and the other at the feet of where Jesus had been. And they're just sitting there. I mean, there's all kinds of speculation, I guess, you could make at this point. Now, what were they doing just sitting there? It seems to me that probably they were there for the purpose of speaking to Mary and introducing her to the realization that Jesus had risen from the dead. I mean, you say, what else? Why would they be there? They weren't protecting anything, and they certainly weren't at that moment doing anything. They were sitting down, and Mary peeks in, and then they carry on this conversation with her. So that's just one of those oddities in the story that you don't really know. But apparently Jesus may have just told those angels, just sit here and wait for Mary. He knew she was going to be the first one to show up, and I want you to talk to her. But anyway, that's what happened. And then we just read the discourse. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back. Of course, it's doubtful that she realized that they were angels. They had the appearance of men. Excuse me. So they may not have even realized, or she may not have even realized that they were angels. The scripture tells us that they were. So when she had thus said, she spoke to these two, she thought men, they were angels, turned back. And when she did, she saw Jesus standing, but knew not that it was Jesus. Now, Mary knew him very well. She was, a woman that he had forgiven of her sin, and she had come to know him as her Savior. She was with him among the disciples. She was one of the women that was most faithful to him. And yet she did not recognize him after she saw him as a resurrected Christ. The appearance of Jesus in the resurrected body was not the same as it was in his earthly body. It was a glorified body, no doubt. It was a magnificent appearance that she had probably not been used to, whatever, she did not recognize him. Verse 15, Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, Sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus saith unto her, Mary. And then she turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Whenever he called her by name, she recognized him as Jesus. Now, the message that Jesus gave to Mary was, Why weepest thou? Why weepest thou? You know, this life is filled with many tears. And the Bible says that God collects the tears of his people in a bottle. That could be a figurative form of speech, of course. Is it a literal bottle? We don't know. But the point is that the Lord sees every tear, and he feels the pain of every tear. It is not lost on him when we are hurting and when we are sorrowful and when we are tearful. He knows it. He feels it. He empathizes with us, et cetera, et cetera. Mary was filled with grief and loneliness, and she was missing Jesus, and she was weeping because she missed him. And he said to her, Why weepest thou? I am alive forevermore, Mary. I will wipe away all of your tears one day. And he will, you know. He will wipe away our tears. We will not even remember when we are with him. We will not even remember the things that made us weep. The tears will forever be gone. There will be no single tear shed after the Lord wipes them away in heaven. So he says to her, Why weepest thou? Giving her a message of hope. And I know it's hard to think that way whenever we are in the midst of suffering and in the midst of pain and in the midst of sorrow and in the midst of tears. But remember, Jesus rose from the dead. He's already conquered our fears. He's conquered our tears. He's conquered all those things in our lives. And even though we get caught up in the moment, in our flesh, which is sinful and weak and always Adamic, susceptible to all these emotions and feelings and fears and so forth, if somehow by faith we could try to remember that Jesus rose from the dead, and he, as such, he's taken away our tears, and he will take them away one day, forever. And right here, he says to her, "Why weepest thou?" When he called her Mary, she recognized who he was. And then he said unto her something very interesting in verse 17. So the first thing was, "Why weepest thou?" He took away her tears. I've risen from the dead. And that, everything is included in that. Everything. By Jesus rising from the dead, everything is included in that. Why weepest thou? But then he said, "Touch me not." No doubt when she recognized who he was, she ran up to him to do what she had always done, to hug him and to embrace him. Jesus was a hugger. Jesus was affectionate with his disciples and with the people that loved him. He was as stern as he could be to his enemies, but to his friends, he was as soft and compassionate as anyone could possibly be. He touched people constantly. Go through the gospel narratives and notice every time you see the scripture recording Jesus touching someone, and it was often. So I'm sure that she was accustomed to his embrace and him hugging her and embracing her and giving her his affection, etc. And no doubt she started to do that whenever she realized who he was, but then Jesus stopped her. Must have been a shock to Mary. And you can imagine everything in her heart wanted to hug him at that moment, realizing that he had risen from the dead. But Jesus stopped her and said, "Touch me not." And then he said, "Why? For I have not yet ascended to my Father." Now, I've read a lot of commentaries on this passage, and I think a lot of them get it wrong. They equate this to the ascension in Acts chapter 1, but that just doesn't make sense. Because remember, on the second Sunday, or the Sunday after Resurrection Sunday, whenever he appeared to the 12, or the 11 now, and the first time he appeared, remember, we're going to get to that in a minute, the first time he appeared, Thomas was not there, you remember? You remember, right? And then they went and told him, you know, "The Lord is risen. I will not believe unless I touch his hands and the wound. I will not believe." So the next Sunday, Jesus appeared to them again. Thomas was there. And what did Jesus say to Thomas? "Touch me. Touch me. Touch my hands. Touch the scars. Touch my side. Touch the scar. It is I." So he told Thomas to touch him. But he hadn't ascended yet, bodily, as is recorded in Acts chapter 1. So why would he tell Mary Magdalene in this passage, "Don't touch me, I have not yet ascended to my Father"? And then he turns around just days later and tells Thomas to touch me. Obviously, something happened between the time that Jesus told Mary not to touch him and the time that he told Thomas to touch him. That makes sense, right? And it wasn't the ascension, but he said, "I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go back to my brethren." Well, I love that. My brethren. my brethren.
Wow.
And saying to them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. I love that. I just love that. Can you imagine to hear Jesus say that? Your Father and my Father, your God and my God, my brethren. What compassion, what assurance that Jesus would say this to these type, and he says that about us. I'm going to ascend. Remember, Jesus is our great high priest. Can I get a strong amen on that? He's our great high priest. Go back to the message that I preached in that Israel series on Jesus, a priest forever, a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And I go into that passage in Hebrews at length and discuss Jesus' high priestly position and responsibility as our great high priest, but according to the order of Melchizedek, which is extremely important. The job of the high priest was, among other things, he would, on the Day of Atonement, once a year, he would go into the Holy of Holies, and he would take the blood from the sacrificial lamb, and he would spill it on the mercy seat inside the Holy of Holies for the forgiveness of the people. He did this annually, once every year. That was the role of the high priest. Jesus is our high priest. When he said, I have not yet ascended to my Father, I believe that what Jesus meant here was that he had not yet fulfilled his role as the great high priest. He had not yet taken his blood that he had shed on the cross. He is the sacrifice. He is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. His blood was shed. I believe that Jesus gathered up the blood that he had shed from the ground and took it to heaven, to the Holy of Holies in heaven, and sprinkled his blood on the mercy seat as our great high priest. And for references on that, I read the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, chapter 10, and chapter 11. Read those three chapters very carefully, and you will see this taught in those passages, that Jesus was our great high priest, that he was the sacrificial lamb, and that his blood was sprinkled on the mercy seat of the Holy of Holies in heaven. So Jesus had not done this yet. And here's the significance of this part of it. If you go back to the Levitical law, whenever the high priest put on his garments in which he would enter the Holy of Holies on the Day of Atonement, as he made his way toward the temple, or the tabernacle, as the case may be, he was forbidden to touch anyone or for anyone to touch him until he had finished his assignment of spilling the blood of the sacrificial animal on the mercy seat. No one could touch him, and he could touch no one. Jesus, our great high priest, fulfilled the law. Every jot and every tittle of the Old Testament Mosaic law was fulfilled in Jesus Christ. So whenever he was preparing to fulfill his role as the great high priest for us, as he was preparing to go into the Holy of Holies in heaven with his blood, he could not allow Mary to touch him. But between here and when he appeared with the 12, obviously he had fulfilled that assignment. And when he returned, and now he says to Thomas, "Here I am, touch me." Because he had already performed his great duty as our great high priest in the Holy of Holies. That is my opinion of what happened here. And I've read many commentators that take an alternate point of view, and feel free to study it for yourself and see if you come to a different conclusion. But to me, that's the only thing that makes sense as to why he would tell Mary, "Do not touch me," and why he would tell Thomas days later, "Touch me." What's the difference? To me, that's the only thing that makes sense. He had to do what Hebrews said he did as our great high priest, and apparently he had not done that at this time. And so he was like the high priest in the Old Testament, could not be touched by any human being, or could not touch a human being until after he had completed his duty to sprinkle the sacrificial blood on the mercy seat in the Holy of Holies. That's what I think this is all about. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples, verse 18, that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things unto her. So that was his first appearance, was to Mary Magdalene. Second appearance, we find beginning in verse 19, to the disciples, but Thomas was absent. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, when the disciples were assembled, notice, for fear of the Jews. For fear of the Jews. They were assembled together in private. The Jewish Sanhedrin had probably, no doubt, put out a warrant for their arrest. The Jewish soldiers were on the move trying to find them, etc. So they were assembled together and they were trying to avoid the Jews. Came Jesus and stood in the midst and said to them, and here's the message he gives to them, "Peace be unto you." They were gathered together in fear. Right? They were there because they were afraid. The message Jesus gave to them, "Peace be unto you. You don't need to be afraid. I'm alive. I've risen from the dead." Mary Magdalene needed a message of, "There's no need to weep." The disciples needed the message, "There's no need to fear." Whatever the message is that we need is the message that the Lord has for us. And if you want to know the message that God has for you on Sunday or on a Wednesday night through the preaching and teaching of His Word, you know what the message is that God has for you? It's the one the devil wants you to miss. It's the one the devil will make it easy for you to be absent. The message that you most need is often the message the devil will keep you from hearing. The devil looks over the shoulder of the pastor as he prepares the message. He knows what the message is going to be. And he knows what you need many times. And if he can keep you away from the message that you need on that Sunday or that Wednesday, he will do it. And so you mark it down. When the devil makes it easy for you to be away from the message, that's probably the message that the Lord wants you to hear. To Mary, it was weep not. To the disciples, it was fear not. Each of them needed a different message, and Jesus gave them the message that they needed in their heart at that moment. Peace be unto you. In verse 20, he showed them his hands and his side. Probably didn't say it right here, but they may have touched him at this point, probably did. There's no evidence that he restricted them like he did previously with Mary. So he had, on the same day, resurrection day, he had gone to heaven and done his high priestly work. And I like this next sentence. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Well, I guess so. Put yourself in their place. They were glad when they saw the Lord. I guess this begs a good moment to ask the question, will you be glad when you see the Lord? There's some people that are not going to be glad when they see the Lord, because he's not going to be their friend. He's going to be their judge. They're not going to be happy campers when they meet him. But to those who know him and love him, to those who have served him, we will be glad when we see him. They were glad. And then he said in verse 21, he said it a second time, peace be unto you. So again, the message to Mary was weep not. The message to the disciples was fear not. The third instance of his appearance after his resurrection, we begin in verse 26. And after 8 days again, so this would be the next Sunday following, his disciples were within and Thomas with them. So Thomas missed church on that first resurrection morning. And next Sunday, though, he, I guess, at least repented enough to be gathered together with the brethren. And he was there. And Jesus came, the doors being shut. In other words, Jesus didn't walk through the door. He walked through the wall. He walked through the wall. The resurrected, glorified body is not bound to the physical laws of nature. He just walks through the wall. There he was. Shows up. And then he saith to Thomas specifically, reach hither thy finger, behold my hands. Reach hither thy hands and thrust it into my side. Be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. And I love Jesus' response to Thomas. Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. You had to see me to believe. The ones who are more blessed than you, Thomas, are the ones that will never see me in the flesh, but they believe me nonetheless. We come to Christ by faith, and we live for Christ by faith, not by sight, by faith. So again, to the 12, he says in verse 26, peace be unto you. This, he said it twice, the first Sunday, the second Sunday with all the 11 there. He says it again. He talks specifically to Thomas. And Thomas, of course, I'm sure he must have felt like this tall when he saw Jesus and so forth. But Jesus then, of course, gave the great admonition of faith, which you and I are to live by. The next time he appears is beginning in chapter 21, verse 1. There are seven disciples that are present. We are told who the names of five, but two of them we're not told who they are. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, which is the Sea of Galilee, and on this wise showed he himself. There were together, and here's the ones that are named, Simon Peter, Thomas, called Didymus. Hooray! Everybody give it up for Thomas. Yay, Thomas. He was there again. And Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. So we don't know who the two other were. They're not named for some reason. So Simon said, I'm going fishing. They also said, we're going to go too. They went forth, entered a ship. All night they were fishing on the Sea of Galilee. They caught nothing. Morning comes around, and they look on the shore, and there was a figure on the shore, but the disciples didn't know who he was. That's verse 4. Jesus hollered out to them. They were about 100 yards offshore. Children, have you any meat? Have you caught anything? And they said, no. And he said, well, why don't you try casting your nets on the other side of the boat? And they did, and they, of course, caught an innumerable number of fish. Verse 7, then that disciple whom Jesus loved, and you in the book of John will see that phrase repeated quite a bit. Who is this person? John. John never talked about himself by name. The humility of these men at times is really remarkable. And as John writes the book of John, that humility comes through again and again. He wouldn't even refer him to himself by name. He simply says, the disciple whom Jesus loved. Well, John was the one that sat next to him at the suppers. John was the one that leaned on him. John was the one that apparently had a closer communication with Jesus personally than any of the other disciples. You remember at the Last Supper, whenever Jesus had said that one of you is going to betray me, Simon Peter, who must have been next to John, says to John, find out who it is. Peter didn't feel confident enough to ask Jesus himself the question. But he knew that Jesus and John had a relationship that he or any of the others did not have. And so he says to John, ask him who it is. And John did. He asked him who it was. And Jesus answered him. It's the one that I give the sop to. He said that to John. The others didn't hear that. And then he gave the sop to Judas. And then when Judas left, the rest of the 12, the 11, figured that he was going off to do something because he was the treasurer, and they thought maybe he was going to do something that, you know, that needed to be done that Jesus had assigned to him, and they had no idea. The only person at the table that knew that Judas was the betrayer and that he was going to betray Christ at that moment was John. That's the kind of close fellowship John enjoyed with Jesus. And he never referred to himself by name, but he would always say, the one whom Jesus loved. John knew Jesus loved him. Has it dawned on you that Jesus loves you? Has it dawned on you that Jesus loves you? It's one thing to say that, and it's another thing to know it in your heart of hearts, in your soul of souls, to know Jesus loves you. Wow. I remember one of the first professors I had in Bible college making a statement one time. I've never forgotten it. I hope I never do. He said, "Gentlemen, the day you realize that Jesus loves you is the day that will change your life forever." What are most people doing normally? Complaining to God. Questioning God. Everything God brings into our lives, He does because He loves us. These disciples were martyred for their faith in Christ. He allowed them to go through intense suffering even before they were martyred. It was not an easy life for them. Many hardships. But Jesus had already proved to them He loved them. And over and over and over through the book of John, the author John says, the disciple whom Jesus loved did this. Speaking of himself. I will say to you what my professor said to that class of preachers years ago. The day you realize that Jesus really loves you is a day that will change your life forever. The disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, "It's the Lord." He was the first one to recognize who it was. Now, that makes sense. He knew him better than anyone else. "It's the Lord." Now, when Simon Peter heard it, he girt his fisher's coat onto him, for he was naked. Doesn't mean that he was totally naked. It means he was naked from the waist up. He had taken his shirt and so forth off and was fishing shirtless when he realized that it was Jesus and he was about to go meet him. He put his shirt on. He did not want to meet the Lord without his shirt. There's a lesson there of reverence and so forth that Peter demonstrates just by this mere fact. And then the other disciples came in the little ship. They were not far from land, as it were, 200 cubits, that's about 100 yards, dragging their nets with fishes. But Simon Peter, as soon as he puts his shirt back on, he dives into the water and he swims to shore. He couldn't wait to see the Lord. He couldn't wait to meet him. He couldn't wait to fellowship. He didn't even bother get the fish. He let the other guy, "You take care of the fish." He dives in the water and he swims to shore. He's so excited about seeing the Lord. I mean, the humanity of these men comes out so much as you read through their lives. You can just, but that makes sense, doesn't it? Doesn't that make sense that it would be Simon Peter that would do that? Come on, we've talked about these disciples before. Simon Peter, the spontaneous one. Simon Peter, the sanguine. Simon Peter, he was always the one that was the first to be excited and maybe the first to be depressed. He was just that kind of a guy. And so it's only natural. It just makes sense that it would be Simon among the seven guys here that would, "It's the Lord." John says, "Oh, it's the Lord." In the water he goes, swimming. I mean, that's just Simon. Gotta love the guy. You gotta love Simon Peter. And so the rest of them, they get all their fish together and they take the boats. And then they drew the fish, 153, verse 11. And then there were so many that the net should have broken, but didn't. And then Jesus said, verse 12, and here's the message he gave to these to these disciples. The first message was, weep not. The second message was, fear not. The third message was, let's eat breakfast. Let's eat breakfast. Come and dine. It was in the morning. It was in the morning. So it was a breakfast meal. Man, can you imagine? You know what this tells me too? Remember, this is Jesus in the resurrected body. This is the Jesus that walked through walls. This is the Jesus that doesn't need to eat to live. He doesn't have to eat to sustain his body. This is a glorified body, resurrected body. It's not susceptible or bound to the laws of the physical laws of nature. So he didn't have to eat to sustain his life. He ate because he enjoyed eating. And you all just going to sit there? I'm looking at you. You're looking at me. I know you like to eat. You know I like to eat. What are you doing just sitting there? I said, Jesus ate because he enjoyed eating. He enjoyed eating. When we get to heaven, we're going to eat. Some of the best times that we have in this life are had around a dinner table. Some of the best memories are around a dinner table. Jesus brings these, and not all together, seven of them there, and he says, come on, fellas. I got the fire going. Bring the fish. Let's eat. Wow. Can you imagine what it would be like to sit down and have breakfast with the resurrected Christ? One day you will. One day you will. One day we will sit around him and we will feast on the banquet that he has in store for us. We will fellowship with him, friend to friend. I don't know about you, but I don't go out to eat with just everybody. I don't go out to eat with just anybody. Not just anybody will I sit down at a table with and eat. I don't trust them. They are not a friend. And I will not make myself vulnerable to them. The Bible tells us in the New Testament about disorderly brethren, that we are not to fellowship with them, that we are not supposed to eat with them. No, not eat. Read it in the scripture. Don't even eat dinner with them. They are no good. You're wasting your time. You're jeopardizing your safety. Don't even eat with them. That is a command of scripture. I don't just eat with anybody. And I've said for many, many years in the pastorate, look, if you got a beef with me and you want to tell me off and give me a piece of your mind, don't invite me out to eat to do it. Sitting down at a table is for friends and lovers to fellowship with, to be comfortable with, to enjoy each other's company. It's not just for anyone. Jesus invited those disciples to eat with him. What a scene that must have been. What thrill must have been in their hearts. Verse 14, now this was the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he was risen from the dead. The next occurrence is still in the process of eating, and as they were dining and so forth, then this conversation takes place between Jesus and Simon Peter. As Jesus had talked specifically to Thomas in the second meeting, now on this occasion he speaks specifically to Simon Peter. And there have been thousands of messages preached on this passage. This is where three times Jesus says to Simon, "Lovest thou me? Simon, lovest thou me?" "Well, yeah, Lord, you know I love you." And then he says it again a few minutes later, "Simon, do you love me?" "Yeah, Lord, you know I love you." And then he says it the third time, "Simon, do you love me?" And now Simon's heart is grieved. He asked him three times. And there's a Greek play on words here, and I'm not going to get into all that. I think I've probably spoken on that maybe a long time ago. And there's so many messages on this. And there is a Greek play on words in the exchange that Jesus uses with Simon Peter that we can't read just casually as you read it in the English. But again, I don't want to dwell on that tonight. He asked him three times, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me?" "Yes, yes, yes. Feed my lambs, feed my sheep," three times. And then in verse 18, here's what I want to focus on tonight. Jesus said to Simon, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not." And then John explains what Jesus was saying to Simon in verse 19. "This spake he, signifying by what death he," Peter, "should glorify God." And after he said that, Jesus said that to Simon. In other words, Simon, you're gonna die a martyr's death when you get older. And when he talks about the hands being stretched out, there's no question the vivid memory of Jesus on the cross and the crucifixion of Rome, etc., was very fresh in all their minds. He was depicting a crucifixion death. He was saying to Simon Peter, "You're going to be crucified on a cross." And he was. That's how he died. Church history says, and most of the sources I've read, if not all, concur with this, say that when Simon Peter was about to be crucified, as they were getting ready to crucify him, he said to his executioners, "I am not worthy to be crucified as was my Lord." And so they tipped him upside down and crucified him head down. And that's how he died. Now, after Jesus told him how he was going to die, would you really want to know how you're going to die? I don't think most of us would really want to know that. It's a good thing the Lord doesn't tell us that. But he told Simon. He didn't say that to the others, that at least not that it's recorded. But he said it to Simon, "This is how you're going to die." And then he said to Simon, after telling him how he's going to die, he said, "Follow me." "You still going to follow me?" Well, there's a message somewhere in there for all these rah, 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 smoke and mirror music churches on Sunday that it's all about themselves and it's all about feeling good and it's all about. And in their message there somewhere, "This is how you're going to die, Simon. This is what I have in store for you. Now, come on, follow me." How many people would still want to follow Jesus after knowing that? And he did. He did follow him. He preached on the day of Pentecost. He wrote two books of the New Testament. He became the apostle to the circumcision, as Paul was to the uncircumcision. He was one of the pillars of the church, Paul said in the book of Galatians. He did follow Jesus. By the way, side note here. Do I got time? Yeah. Remember the story when Simon Peter was in prison and Herod was going to execute him? He'd already executed James. He beheaded him. And he saw that the Jews loved it so much, he was going to execute Simon Peter. Remember? And Simon, do you remember this? And Simon's in jail. And the angel came to get him out. And what was Simon Peter doing when the angel found him? Sound asleep. No sleeping pills. He's about to be executed. The next day he's going to be executed. And he's sound asleep. Could you do that on the day before your execution? How could Simon Peter be sound asleep the day before he's supposed to be executed? Jesus told him, when he's old, you're going to be crucified. You're not going to be beheaded like James was. And you're not going to be executed until you're old. Simon Peter knew it wasn't time yet for him to die. And he fell asleep in the prison cell the day before he was scheduled to be executed and slept like a little baby. So much so that when the angel came to spring him out of jail, I guess the angels of heaven don't know anything about Romans chapter 13 and submitting to the authorities of men. They just came in and they had to kick him. They had to kick him to wake him up. Like some of you need to be kicked right now. What? It goes back to this right here. Simon Peter knew, I'm not going to die tomorrow. I'm not going to be beheaded, and I'm not old. Jesus said when I'm old, I'm not going to die yet. He slept like a baby. Man, the faith of these men, the love of these men, the courage of these men. I mean to tell you, like I was saying Sunday, there is no other explanation for the change of attitude, the change of heart, the change of conduct in the lives of these men other than the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. It changed them into men that would rarely be seen in the world. And so then, but the one thing, Peter, the impetuous one. It's just him, it's Peter. Verse 20, then Peter, turning about, seeth the disciple. There it is again, the disciple whom Jesus loved. Who is that? Come on, folks, help me out here. John. Okay, thank you. Seeth John, which also leaned on his breast at supper. Again, that's John. And said, Lord, and said, which is he that betrayeth thee? That's John. Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, and what about this guy? Lord, what about John? I mean, you just told me how I'm going to die. I'm going to die a cruel death. What about John? Isn't that just like Peter? I mean, impetuous. Just says whatever is on his mind. You know, he just blurts it out. What about John? You know, he's looking for a little help here. Misery loves company. Come on, give me some. And what did Jesus say to him? Jesus said, if I will that he tarry till I come, if he never dies, if I let him live until I come again, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. You don't worry about my will for John. You just worry about my will for you. You just take care of my will for you. You let me take care of John. John is not your concern. You're your concern. That's pretty good advice for all of us. Then went the saying abroad that the disciple would not die. Yet Jesus didn't say to him, he shall not die, but if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? So John says, he never did say that I wasn't going to die. He just said, what if it was my will? They took him and ran with it. John's never going to die. John's never going to die. Well, John did outlive all the other disciples. He was the last disciple to die. They even boiled him in oil, according to church history. And he survived somehow. And after that, they shipped him off to Patmos, and that's where, of course, he wrote the book of the Revelation. And then he did leave Patmos, and he was preaching according to, again, this is all church historians, he was preaching in the church of Ephesus, actually preaching in the pulpit at the church of Ephesus when he died, in his 90s. And that's how John died, apparently. And so he would have been the only one that wasn't actually executed by his enemies, although apparently they did try to execute him when they boiled him and all of that. I figured that after he survived that, I guess they said, well, if the guy survives that, I guess we'll let him live or whatever. But apparently that's the story. Then the last example, and we'll real quickly in Acts chapter 1, is whenever the disciples were together, and that's whenever Jesus gave them the Great Commission. Well, first they ask him, when are you going to establish the kingdom to Israel? And Jesus said, it's not for you to know. And then he gives them the Great Commission, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And then when he'd spoken that, verse 9, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight, and he ascended. But look at verse 3. To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days. This is the only reference we have to the length of time between his resurrection and his ascension. 40 days. Between the time that he rose and the time that he ascended, 40 days. He spoke with them, he walked with them, talked with them, ate with them, speaking the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And then, of course, the rest follows. He appeared unto, according to Paul, 500 brethren at once, the greater part of which are still alive, he said. And so for 40 days after his resurrection, he interacted with his disciples and with others, showed himself that he was alive with, as Luke said, many infallible proofs. And then the last meeting he had with them here in Acts chapter 1, and they physically saw him ascend to the Father. And one day we will see him come again. All right, let's stand for a word of prayer.